Good afternoon all, and welcome to a new session of COVID-19 Academy. As you already know, COVID-19 Academy is a capacity building initiative of NDMA, UNICEF, WHO, HCL Foundation, and Sphere India for volunteers and outreach workers from across India for COVID-19 preparedness and response. Today's session is on welfare of animals in need during COVID-19 crisis. Community and companion animals are one of the many affected sections of society owing to COVID-19 and the resultant nationwide lockdown. With summer upon us and commercial activity coming to a grinding halt, several animals that were dependent on human sources of food are now left to fend for themselves in many parts of the country. This course will aim to put the right information on COVID-19 and animals in the hands of cattleists who can further disseminate them within the larger community, leading to relief for animals. We have two eminent speakers for the session today, Mr. Sumant Bindu Madhav from Humane Society International and Mr. Hansen Thambi Prem from World Animal Protection. Mr. Sumant is a nature education and wildlife management professional with close to 20 years of experience in the field. In his current role as campaign manager for Wildlife for Humane Society International India, he leads the organization's work on human-wildlife conflict management, illegal wildlife trade, olive ridley turtle conservation, and capacity building. He has served as faculty for various state judicial academies and the National Judicial Academy, as well as trained scores of officers from the police and forest department for several states in the wildlife laws. Mr. Hansen has a master's degree in social work with nearly 15 years of experience in managing programs related to disaster management, sustainable livelihoods, and environmental conservation. He is specialized in international humanitarian standards and participatory approaches. Since the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami, he has been working with the United Nations, Red Cross movement, government and non-government organizations to protect disaster-affected communities, people and animals in South Asia. He is closely working with governments and international humanitarian stakeholders to integrate animals into their disaster management policies, plans, and programs at all administrative levels. Thank you, dear speakers, and welcome to our session, and over to you.
Hi, Praveen. Thank you for the introduction. Very good afternoon to all. So, in fact, on behalf of World Animal Protection, I would like to extend my sincere thanks and gratitude to the organizers of this COVID Academy, especially the Sphere India, National Disaster Management Authority, UNICEF, and other stakeholders who have been behind this initiative, HCL Foundation, and so on. So in fact, this is a very good initiative, which helps us to stay connected online and share the knowledge and information that we have amongst the people who care for the welfare of both people and animals. And once again, I would like to stress upon the point on, as we all are living in a situation that is really very uncertain, and it's a very difficult time at the moment. And we need to see how we can take measures to protect ourselves. At the same time, we also would like to emphasize the fact that animals are the biggest sufferers, because in the society that we can see, in the different aspects, animals are being affected. So I will be talking in my presentation about how the COVID-19 has impacted animals in different sectors of the society that we live in, and how it has affected people as well, and also what are the safety and precautionary measures we could take to safeguard our pets, our community animals, other animals, along with our safety. So with that, I would like to start the presentation and welcome you all once again, and I would like to share, there are a lot of rumors and there are a lot of fake news going around on animals. But yeah, we will be addressing some of those queries, some of the questions that are coming up from a lot of people. So we'll be talking in the presentation on what are these areas, what are true and what we need to follow, and why we should not get misled by fake or rumors, especially related to animals. And yeah, I'm sharing my screen so that we can go through the presentation together. So yes, so in this presentation, we'll be talking about animals. As I said before, animals itself means we are going to talk about a lot of different types of animals, because animals in itself is a very diverse subject, because there are a lot of farm animals that are impacted, wild animals, companion animals, and livestock, apart from many other different captive animals and so on. So all animals in this scenario of COVID-19 has been impacted, and how they're impacted and what role can we play as responsible citizens and responsible people who love and take care of animals, what we can do to ensure the safety of animals as well as ourselves. So in this presentation, the objective of this session will be mainly two aspects. One is, by the end of this session, we want to see that the public understands the impact of COVID-19 on animals. How has this COVID-19 impacted animals? We'll be getting to see that. Second, what precautions can we take for the safety of our pets and community animals in order to help both animals and people? So these two will be the main objectives of this session. So in this, I'll be accompanied with my friend also from HSI, who will be talking about aspects of how the animals can be protected from this situation and from their organization's point of view as well. So we'll be dividing. I'll be taking the first 30 minutes, and then Sumanth will be discussing another 30 minutes of the session, and then we can have the questions or anything that you have in specific to discuss about this issue. So in this contents, we'll be talking about why we need to protect animals in disasters. In general, apart from COVID-19, in general, if you look at the animals, why is it important that we need to protect animals? Second, animals in COVID-19 itself. So what has it got to do with animal lives? Has COVID-19 impacted animals, and how? Third component will be animals in disaster initiative. This is World Animal Protection has come out with a series of initiatives online to see how we can protect animals in this situation, as well as in animals in disasters in general, which I'll be sharing through this presentation. And there are a lot of challenges in addressing the needs of animals in COVID-19, as well as in disaster situations, which we need, we as a community, we as a country, we as a humanitarian sector, all need to come together to see how we can address this in a collective way. So having said this, I'll move on with the first topic of the presentation. So why do we need to protect animals from disasters? So often the question comes, there are a lot of needs for people that we need to do in disasters. Why do we need to protect animals in disasters? Is it really necessary? So to share with you some of the facts that gives you a strong base and reason why we need to protect animals. Globally, if you see, 1.3 billion people are dependent on animals for different various reasons. So they're dependent. So this shows how much dependence animals have on people. How much dependence the people have on animals for their survival, for their livelihood, for their companionship, and so on. The second point or the fact I would like to put forth to you all is, in India, 70% of the livestock that is owned by 67% of the poor and vulnerable people in the country, which itself says the poor and the vulnerable people who are already prone to disasters, already prone to all kinds of vulnerabilities, they own a significant population of livestock, that is 70%, which means most of the animals are already at risk, already in a vulnerable situation, which is why we need to protect animals. And there's another interesting statistics given out by Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, which talks about 36% of disaster losses are being absorbed by the livestock subsector itself. If you talk about the agriculture sector, 40% is absorbed by the agriculture sector. Whereas if you look at more specifically, 36% of the disaster losses is getting absorbed by the livestock subsector, which means livestock sector is contributing a lot for the risk reduction and the resilience of the vulnerable communities. And more specific to India, as per the Central Water Commission's data, I would like to also emphasize the fact that we don't have enough data to highlight the impact of disasters on animals. But still, whatever data we have, whatever government data we have, clearly shows the impact it has on animals and why we need to seriously look into it. So in the country, 97,000 cattle are lost due to floods every year in India. So if you look at the stats more closely, it talks about one species of animal, that is cattle, and one specific disaster, that's floods. So this itself is a very, very significant number. 97,000 cattle is not a small number. But again, the question lies is, what happens to the other species? What happens to the other disasters? I would like to admit to the fact that we don't have enough data. We are not documenting enough. We are not reporting enough. And that's a very big challenge. So this data that we already have itself shows how big the issue is on animals and why it's important that we need to protect animals from disasters. Second point of the statistics is, if you look at the livestock related activities, especially in the rural areas, 90% of the activities are managed by women, which means even though if the animals are owned by men, 90% of the activities related to livestock care and management is carried out by women, which means livestock plays a very important role in women empowerment and gender equality. That's why we cannot ignore this issue and we should take responsibility in protecting animals. And the final point, statistics is, we are talking about the growth of the nation, the economic development of the country. And if we need to focus in that direction, I think livestock sector contributes very significantly to the agriculture GDP, which is nearly 25% of the contribution comes from the livestock sector in the form of milk and milk products, which is very significant. Whereas when we say agriculture GDP, all we can think is about the crop producers and the food grains and so on. But the importance of livestock is never highlighted. So having said all the statistics, I would like to move on to the actual issue. Now coming to the actual issue on animals in COVID-19. So here, what is the issue? We saw the seriousness of why it is important to protect animals in disasters, and what are the things that we need to, why the statistics says that it is important that we need to consider to work together towards its protection. Whereas when we talk specific to the animals in COVID-19, there are several issues that are emerging every day. So some 4 points, I would like to categorize them under 4 points. One is, animal needs are being compromised. As we all are working towards our safety, people's safety, the community's safety, the country's safety, no one's denying that. But we need to realize that we should never compromise the needs of the animals, which is equally important. So this is one big issue that the animals in the country and globally are facing. Second point, animals are seen as threats. See, there is no clear scientific data till date that animals can transmit this disease to people and has been infected by this issue. But still, animals are seen as threat. And this is a big issue for the safety and the welfare of animals. Third, animals are being abandoned. In the community, due to a lot of rumors, fake news, animals are getting stigmatized. And as a result of this, animals are getting abandoned, be it pet animals, be it community animals, be it any animals that we see in our day-to-day life are facing serious threat and issues as a result of this COVID-19's impact. And the fourth main point I would like to share is, in general, animals are not at all a priority as of now, which I understand the foremost priority is the people's life, the community, and so on. But certainly we as a community, we as responsible people, who are responsible for other lives, can certainly take our meaningful actions in the nearby vicinity of where we live to protect animals. But certainly we need to consider these are the fact that animals are not still considered as a priority, and it's high time that we need to work together in addressing this issue as well. So, moving on, in the society, how are animals getting facing issues, and what are the different types of issues or challenges faced by the animals? These also I would like to categorize under five areas. So if you look at a house, so the people, especially the people who own pets at home, the relationship between the pet and their owners, the pet owners, the relationship between them has got strained. So we need to agree to the fact that certainly there are a lot of pressure. Certainly there are a lot of issues under this situation, under this lockdown, where we are finding it really challenging to meet our personal and family needs. But certainly this is also putting an added strain on the relationship between the pets and their owners. So this is an issue that you can see at the household level. And this is resulting into different reasons of abandonment or many other ill-treating of animals or killing of animals in many situations as well, which is totally unacceptable. Second, if you look at a community, so we have been seeing community dogs, community cows, cattle in a day-to-day life. Now, after this fake news and rumors, they are getting stigmatized in the community, which is, through this forum, I would like to certainly say that please don't believe all such rumors or fake news unless you get any information from a genuine source, from the government or from the World Health Organization or from the World Organization for the Animal Health, and reliable sources. So this is a reason why animals are getting stigmatized, and this is really very bad for the animals. And as a society, we need to have that element of compassion towards all forms of life. And the third element is livestock. As I said before, India, a lot of people have a strong relationship with the livestock for their livelihood, and they are part of the family in most of the rural areas. And nearly it's a significant number of people, that significant population of animals are with such people, that 70% of livestock. And in this situation, due to the lockdown, and there is a lot of issues that these animals are facing due to deficit of feed and fodder. I understand it's a challenging issue, but I think we also need to see what we can do from our local level, through the local government support, through the community support, to whatever extent is possible, how we can meet this requirement to ensure that animals don't starve to death. We provide them the basic feed and fodder for their survival at least. So this is a big challenge faced by the livestock in the country. Fourth aspect is farms. When I say farms, it's about animal farms. There are many animal farms. You might see poultry farm, different animal farms where the animals are seen as just objects. They are being dumped. They are being just thrown out. They are not even treated as a life. So we need to see that these animals are not seen as mere objects. but as sentient beings, and treat them and give them the value that they deserve. And there is a lot of issues with the animal farms. And finally, the captivity. There are a lot of animals in the zoos, wild animals in the zoos, and they are helpless because they are kept captive. And we need to see how their needs also are met, because there are issues of where we as a society need to take responsibility for ensuring that they have the basic survival needs as we all require during this situation as well. So with this, I would like to move on to the other points mentioned in the content. So Animals and Disasters Initiative of World Animal Protection, we have come up with some series of initiatives to see how we can address this issue of animals and disasters in general and animals in COVID-19 specific as well. So the first important step I would like to urge on behalf of World Animal Protection to all the public and is we need to promote responsible pet ownership at this time, because there are people, either there is a strained relationship with the owner and the pet, or there is a strained relationship with the neighbors who are threatening the people who are owning pets, which is really something that we need to discourage and ensure that there's no such issues with the animals there. And it's we need to promote what is reliable and the genuine information that we get. So we have come out with a Protect Your Pet initiative. You can go through the link. The link is provided here. So anyone who is owning a pet can enter the details here, sign up, and you can get a free pack. You can download a free pack. This is nothing but a disaster survival kit. It's like a checklist of items that you need to download and ensure that you have, so that you can ensure the safety of your pets in your house. So this is one initiative which I would like to share through this forum to you all. So you can please go through this link on our website and get to know about this as well. The second aspect is, we have come out with this, there are a lot of doubts of what we should do and what we should not do with animals, especially pet animals. So we have come up with do's and don'ts. So I will touch upon some of the do's and don'ts in this situation for animals. So talking about the do's in this situation is, you need to maintain sanitary measures as per government guidelines, that is for utmost importance, and wash your hands after petting, walking, feeding your pets or community animals. So this is a general practice. It's a basic hygiene that you need to follow. It's nothing that you're against animals or something. It is just basic hygiene practices that you need to follow, which is something we advise you certainly need to do. It's like us. We need to wash our hands as we go out, as we go touch someone. It's equally the same when you are dealing with pets. After you're petting or walking or feeding your pets, please ensure that you wash your hands and maintain basic hygiene. What are the don'ts? Don'ts would like to say is, like kissing your pets or community animals. Here, if you see here, we know that you have a strong emotional bonding with your pet, but we don't advise that, because like we do have bacteria in our mouth as well. Same, it also, there are bacteria in animals, so we don't advise to kiss your pets or community animals. Or you might ask, do we need to put a mask on our pet? So we advise, no, please don't put mask on your pets, as it can interfere with their breathing, especially with flat-faced breeds like pugs, bulldogs, and so on, who already naturally have a labored breathing, and they can suffer from heat stroke. So these are some of the don'ts. So please see that you don't, because we are also wearing masks, we can say that we also put a mask to our pet. No, we know that you have concern of your pet, but please don't do that. It's not necessary. So moving on to the second aspect of the do's and don'ts is, ensure your house is clean and disinfect surface frequently. This is obviously we do it regularly, and we advise you to do it as more frequently as possible. Try and maintain physical activity with your pet or community animals during lockdown. So here is, because your pet needs physical activity, and we we encourage people to try to see how you can maintain that physical activity that they need within whatever spaces that are available in your locality, within your house premises, within your campus premises, as per the government norms. And the don'ts is, please don't abandon your pets due to rumors and fear of coronavirus, which is, we don't advise that, because there is no such fear that you need to carry with you. And there is no fear that you need to say someone that you should stop owning a pet. Please don't do that. And please don't contact your pets or community animals, including petting, snuggling, kissed or licked, and sharing food if you are sick with COVID-19. And yeah, this is obviously, this naturally applies when to a normal person. The same will apply for a pet if you're owning. Please don't do that, because it is for the safety of both you and your pets, right? And the next aspect is, we do advise, please consult with the vet if you suspect that you, your pet or community animal is not well. So that is very important, because people naturally tend to feel that if my pet is not feeling well at this situation, it might be COVID-19. No, it's not the case. There are several reasons why your pet can get unwell. So you will get the right answer only when you contact the veterinarian, the local veterinary doctor, who can be the best guide for you. And you can feed community animals while taking all necessary precautions. So no issues with that, please. But don't go in the lockdown just because I need to feed animals. I'm going out and breaking all the government rules, and I need to walk out and take the risk. No, within your vicinity, within whatever area is possible, within your nearby house is possible, please do that. Don't go beyond what is not needed at this moment. And recommend people to take care of animals. And we certainly recommend, please promote the compassion towards all life forms, and take care of the animals in your nearby areas and your vicinity. This we certainly encourage. And also, like, the don'ts is, if you are sick from coronavirus, do not go out, including feeding animals. Yeah, that is, you need to maintain the social distancing at this time. And don't give your pet any vaccination without consulting your vet. So yeah, there are cases where people say, and should I give a specific vaccination for my pet to say that it can be safe from COVID-19? So no, it's not necessary at the moment, because the one that is here is not for this specific cause, it's for another reason. So you need to consult with your vet of what your pet requires and decide according to that. But please don't take any hasty decisions at this moment. And for more detailed information on these do's and don'ts, you can visit this link, which is given on this presentation slide as well. So you can read and know more in detail, or you want to share it with your friend, you can please do so. Yeah, so with this, I would like to move upon another aspect. So we are also encouraging volunteer support. So we have identified some volunteers within, especially in Delhi, where we have some contacts to help the animals and care for the animals in the local area. So, and see how we can do. So we also would like to encourage you all, please, if you have any friends, relatives, volunteers, people who can support in that local area, in their neighborhood where they have animals, please encourage that. And also, we are coordinating with the local government officials for supporting people who care for animals. Like, usually people have a fear whether I'll be threatened by the administration, local administration, or the police, or so on. But we are also trying to convey to them why it is important. They too understand it. So please try to communicate this message in the right way, so that the government and the volunteers and us, we all can work together to ensure the safety of the animals as well in this situation. Yeah, so moving on to the next aspect of Q&As. So there are a lot of questions. I'll just move through fast, but if you want, again, in the later session, I can stop and have a detailed discussions on each question. But some of the important points we'll just see quickly. Can dogs get coronavirus? So this is a very general question that's always being getting circulated. And what I would like to say is, as of now, there's no evidence that pets can be a source of infection and they can become sick from coronavirus. This is a clear message. So you need not worry about that as of now. But the important aspect we'd like to say is keep looking out for information because this is an evolving situation. We need to be careful of because we are not sure of the virus as such and how it evolves. But we need to, as of now, there are no such evidences and there is no issues of they can become sick from coronavirus. But please look out for genuine and reliable information from the reliable sources from time to time. Second aspect, what about the Pomeranian and the German Shepherd dogs in Hong Kong that tested positive? Obviously, the next aspect people would like to ask is, so there are cases, reports coming on animals getting sick and so on. Yes, there was a case that they found virus in the mouth and nose, which was tested positive, which was weakly positive, but there was no signs of sickness. So what we advise is, please follow all sanitary measures, such as washing hands before and after we spend time with our animals or touch their belongings. This is something that we need to follow, but they don't have any. This is something that has occurred, but there is no signs of sickness or no signs that they can transmit it to people. The next point, obviously, we have already shared this. Can I kiss and hug my animals? Which obviously we say, please, kissing them is never a good idea. As we too carry bacteria in our mouth, same, it applies for them as well. So what we advise is, please wash your hands before and after petting or walking or feeding the animals. So the fourth is, should I avoid contact with my pets if I'm sick with COVID-19? That people sick with COVID-19 should limit contact with animals until more information is known about the virus. Yeah. So please, because we still don't know the situation of how this virus is emerging and evolving, whatever information we have, whatever information we have got from the reliable sources, we need to go by that. So please limit your contact with animals and wait for reliable information, but ensure you maintain all the hygiene practices. If I have coronavirus, do I need to quarantine my dog? The next is, usually we talk about people being home quarantined. Do I need to quarantine my dog if I have coronavirus? No, it's not required. You need not quarantine your pet if you are sick. As per the Center for Disease Control and Prevention recommendation, the people sick with COVID-19 limit contact with animals until more information is known. This situation is emerging every day and we need to wait till we get information from the reliable sources. But as of now, you need not quarantine your pet. If my dog gets ill, what should I do? Yes, this is another important question because in this situation, whoever gets sick, not only dog, even if a person gets sick, we suspect it's of COVID-19. Which is the case, but thing is, please don't panic. Please don't create false information of the situation. You just need to, they can get sick from due to many reasons, many things. The most important thing is, please consult with your vet. Explain to your vet what is happening with your pet, and then you can take a responsible decision as per the veterinary doctor's advice. But please don't come to an assumption. Don't make your own judgments, and please don't follow, go by false or fake news informations. Yeah, this we have already discussed. Should I put a mask on my dog if it is sick? Which we say, no, please don't, because it can interfere with the breathing, and please don't put a mask on your pets or animals. Can I still walk my dog? Yeah, so this is another question because people usually have a habit of, people who are owning pet have a regular routine. They walk their dog every morning. And what we advise is, if you please follow all the government rules and regulations, but if you can still leave your house and not experiencing COVID-19 symptoms within the local vicinity where it is permissible, where you have space, you can still walk your dog. But the another main important reason is, please responsibly discard your dog's waste, because it's very important as a part of basic hygiene that we need to follow. And please encourage this practice within your friend circle or community circle, whoever is owning a pet. And how can I walk my dog in a lockdown situation? Yes. Another question is, can you walk down? Yes, pet, you walk down. If you are able to walk them down and you have the space. Another question is, how can we walk down? Yeah, in this situation, actually, as I said before, pets need a lot of physical activity. And especially dogs and cats will need physical activity. So if you are not having enough space, not able to walk them, you can replace the walk with the kind of play within your house or within your nearby vicinity area, where to encourage some sort of physical activity for your pets, to make them feel engaged with their toy or something at home. But you need to maintain that physical activity with your pets, which is important at this situation, because they can also get stressed and we need to manage that. Should I vaccinate my dog against coronavirus? Another question people ask is, actually for the coronavirus, the current canine coronavirus vaccine is available or made to protect against the digestive system and not coronavirus infection, and not licensed to protect against respiratory infection. This is very important fact that you need to understand. The coronavirus vaccination that is there for canines, it's for the digestive system coronavirus infection and not for the respiratory infection. So there is no evidence that the canine coronavirus vaccine will provide cross protection against an infection with COVID-19 in animals. So this people get confused. So please communicate the right message that this is another kind of infection which has got nothing to do with the canine coronavirus infection. What happens with my companion animal if I am hospitalized? Yeah, it's a very important question. So people actually, even the animal have a very strong bonding with the person who regularly takes to a walk or spend times or have a very close bonding. And it's very difficult to manage this in this situation. So we encourage us, do ensure that somebody, especially who is already familiar with the dog, can temporarily take care till the respective person is hospitalized and can return back to the normal life. Because this can also affect the nature or the behavior of the pets, which we need to see that you need to manage this and address this also. So please try to see if you can identify someone who is familiar or a friend, your relative or family member, who the dog or the cat or is familiar with, and then you can provide temporary care so that also there is an issue if the pet is not in their own home, they become very excited or panic or aggressive at situation. So it's also important you need to take a decision whether you can maintain that pet in their own home or in a relative home. So this is a decision you need to take depending on how you have a relationship with the pet and the person who's going to take care of the pet.
Mr. Hansen, if I may interrupt, yes, since we are running out of time, if you could go a little faster so that the speaker can also finish it on time. Thank you so much.
Sure, Rani. Yeah, I'll just move just faster. Yeah, sure. Yeah,
thank you.
So there's another point of, if I'm an animal caretaker, do I need to stay at home and abandon my job? So this actually would say is, please, it's decision needs to be taken based on what government recommendations are, and you need to follow all the sanitary recommendations. So please don't take just unanimous decision just because there is a situation where the society is stigmatizing you. It's not necessary at all. So I'll just move fast when we can discuss it in the question and answer session later on also. So what is the recommendation for interfering with the free roaming dogs? And still, I would like to emphasize the fact, like pet animals, even the free roaming dogs can get sick from COVID-19, or they don't get sick or they don't spread disease to people. This is a fact. So we just need to follow sanitary measures and safety precautions, and look out for reliable information from the government or from the World Health Organization and World Organization for the Animal Health, OIE. Right. Yes. Is there a risk of pets tracking virus in from outside? Yeah, it certainly is. It is possible for your pets to track virus back into the house, like we do when we go out. So it's as a good practice, we are encourage you to wash your dog's paws with pet safe soap and water. This is a very important point. Please don't use alcohol or household disinfectant on animals, because it can be harm their skin. It can be harsh on them. So if you are going out, please wash your dog's paws with pet safe soap and water, so that the infection doesn't get carried through your pet, like how we carry the infection also. Abandoning, euthanizing their dogs and other animals as a precaution, should I consider doing that as well? No, please. No, it is very unfortunate that there are misplaced fear, people abandoning animals or even euthanizing them. No, this will not resolve the issue and of the pandemic. And in fact, pets are great company and even may decrease the stress levels and suicidal tendency of this situation. In fact, you need to encourage them to see how they can take care of the pets and not discourage them and stigmatize animals in this situation. So I'll move fast. Should my community drive off stray animals in the area or call the local authority? No, never. This, so please, whoever is doing that or whoever is planning to do that, please clearly advise, never. Animals should not become victims. They need our help and protection at this situation, and we need to take responsibility for them. A lot of animal shelters seem to be suffering because people are no longer donating and wanting. Yes, this situation is there. This is a dangerous situation to animals that depend on our care. You can contact the local shelter or donate food or money wherever possible, or help them in whatever ways you can in this situation. Should I continue? Let my dog roamly free in my restricted area. So yeah, in this situation, you need to take a decision not only for yourself, for your pet, but for the community as a whole, because lack of knowledge and awareness can make people react in a different way, which we need to take into consideration. But restriction is applied in letting your dog roam freely because of the safety of the community and all. But please take it in the interest of the society, interest of the people, and in a good faith. And for more information, you can visit the link. Apart from this, we have another initiative called this course. We have an online course on animals and disasters, which is called PrepVet online course. And the link is here. So it's available in Spanish, Portuguese, and English. And anyone is interested can log in and take up this course as well. So it's just a 1 minute video. I'll just click so you can see.
Hello again. When flooding and storms come and folks lose their poultry or their pig farms, their future suddenly comes to a halt. National governments under the UN umbrella have vowed to reduce these grave vulnerabilities. And to help them protect animals as essential assets, we created the PrepVet, a unique online course for veterinarians, civil defense professionals, and you. PrepVet covers topics such as disaster risk, preparedness, and climate change for animals, as well as how to avoid those risks. It actually presents a new niche and a role for veterinarians, and it's free. Because protecting animals, as Maya here will show us throughout the course, is key to help protect the future of their owners, their families, and the communities. I invite you to check the PrepVet on our website and learn more about it.
So that was just a short video about the online course called PrepVet. So anyone's interested to learn about how to manage animals in disasters, you can go through this course. There are 11 modules in this course, and it deals with all this important things that you need to know in managing disasters for animals, managing animals in a disaster situation. So apart from this, in general, there are several areas that World Animal Protection we are working on. Legal frameworks and resources, like how we can get the necessary baseline information related to animals, the disaster response protocols that we need to have in place, capacity building and training of professionals and stakeholders on this issue. And finally, we need to provide a culture of preparedness, or encourage a culture of preparedness, so that animals can get integrated into the humanitarian sector, which is very important. And also, like, we are working to see how we can end the cruel industrial farming and wildlife trade practices, which are creating a lot of issues, and a lot of emerging and re-emerging diseases are a result of it. And also, we are working to see how we can integrate animal protection in insurance and financial sectors, disaster strategies, because insurance is something that we are lacking, especially in our region in Asia and Asia Pacific, for animals, and we need to see how this can be promoted. So with this, the final slide of my presentation is, there are a lot of challenges when it comes to addressing the issues of animals in disasters. One is one health and one welfare, because now we are in a situation where we can see that biological disasters, what the biological disasters can do for all sectors, all people, animals and all. So which is something very important that we need to seriously work on to ensure one health and one welfare of both people and animals. And also we need to come up with a lot of animal protection inclusive policies. The policies that we need to work in humanitarian sector for disasters need to be inclusive of animal protection measures. And in order to control zoonotic diseases, there are a lot of emerging and re-emerging diseases, as I said, needs biosecurity protocols in place, which we are lacking, and which is a very big issue that we need to work together. And research and education on animals in emergencies, it's also a very important aspect that we need to look into. And finally, is the meeting the needs of animals in disasters, there are a lot of resources that are required, be it human resources, financial, material, infrastructure. There is a lot of scope and opportunities, but at the same time, these are the challenges. How we'll address them, and how we'll ensure that these are there in place so that we can take active initiatives to protect animals in disasters. With that, I would like to end my presentation. Thank you all for your patience. I'll go through the queries if you have anything, and we can discuss it in the later after this presentation as well. And we urge everyone to please don't forget the animals, and you can visit our website as well. Thank you, and sorry for taking a bit more time, Praveen and Sumanth, and over to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Hansen. Now I welcome Mr. Sumanth Bindumadha from Humane International. Sumanth, you may take over. You may, and Mr. Hansen, can you? Yeah. Mr. Sumanth, you can share your screen right now.
Sure. Thanks so much, Praveen. Thanks for having me. Thank you so much for that, Hansen. That was very exhaustive and very informative. I'm going to begin my sharing my screen. Fortunately, Mr. Hansen has covered a lot of this, so I'm not going to repeat a lot of what he has said. What I would briefly like to touch upon without overlapping on what Hansen has said is to just briefly look at why this pandemic occurred in the first place. What can we do as members of the community and people who have some reach in the community to prevent another one in future? And finally, what I'd like to spend a little more time on is what we can do in the current scenario to help animals. So starting with the very, very basic, you've probably done a lot of sessions on understanding what a virus is, so I'm not going to dwell into details of this, but it is basically a genetic material that's enveloped in a protein coat. Its primary function is to infect healthy cells, and then replicate and infect more cells in our body. This particular virus, coronavirus, or also known as SARS-CoV-2, is not new to us. Coronaviruses have been around for the longest time. There have been plenty of instances of it in the past. This particular one, there have been some questions about where it originated from. And I do have this small video that I hope will help answer
Wildlife that. Markets are a public health hazard. We know for a fact that the wildlife trade is generating these coronaviruses. But the wildlife trade is also contributing to other problems. It's not only harming human health, but it's also causing species to decline in the wild. The wildlife trade is extremely cruel to the individual animals involved. They're snatched from their homes, they're shoved into cages, they're provided inadequate care, and by the time they get to a market, they're in such terrible condition. These kind of markets occur around the world, so it could happen at any time in any one of these markets. That's why we need all countries to take measures now to prevent the next outbreak from occurring. We really need to close the markets, stop wildlife transport, and encourage people to stop eating wildlife. Stop the wildlife trade. That's the answer.
Right. And I think we have known for a while now that the origin of several of these viruses is one, the wildlife markets, and what's also been called wet markets in China. Wet markets are basically places where there are live animals, as well as animals that are slaughtered for consumption. And that just provides for the perfect breeding ground for pathogens to jump from one species to another. Now, just like we showed in the video, I think there's been plenty of conversation about how bats are the origin of this virus, and there have been many communities that have been calling for mass culling of bats. All of that is absolutely pointless. Like Hansen said, right from humans to dogs to every animal on the planet carries certain pathogens in their body. So killing bats was not going to solve the problem. What is going to solve the problem is to make sure that animal markets such as the one that was just spoken about in the video do not exist anymore. And you'd be surprised to know that many of the clips from that video came from India. We have prime examples of such markets. If any of you are from Bihar, you know that there is Sonpur Mela in Bihar, which is very, very popular, which until 2 years ago used to sell all kinds of wildlife from monkeys to elephants to everything. We ran a litigation in the Patna High Court and had the wildlife market in Bihar closed down. But before that, if you see pictures from Sonpur Mela, you have dogs, parakeets, monkeys, snakes, elephants, all in close proximity to one another. What happens here is the easiest way to clean where these animals are kept is to take a water pipe and just spray water. What that does is that causes to a mix of urine, blood, and feces of multiple species, which is a prime breeding ground for all these pathogens. And these animals are under severe stress, which makes them shed more viruses. One of our colleagues many years ago visited the Wuhan market that's in question right now. When he visited the market, there were 57 species of animals being sold in just that one market. 2/3 of these were wildlife and another 1/3 were domestic and farmed animals. To just briefly look at what we can do to prevent a similar situation from happening in future, one is that we need to be vigilant and work with our district or state administration to ensure there's no sale of wildlife that happens. All wildlife in India is protected under the Wildlife Protection Act. Selling of wildlife is illegal, but there are still places like Crawford Market in Bombay, like Chidiya Bazaar in Hyderabad, Russell Market in Bangalore, Mir Shikar Toli in Bihar, that still sell wildlife. And we know this because we work very closely with law enforcement. We recently did a rescue of two pangolins from one of these markets as well. The wildlife trade is rampant across the country. So what we can do is be vigilant and ensure there's no sale of wildlife at all. The one caveat is that there is exotic wildlife, that is wildlife that's not from our country, like the macaws and some of the parrots and African greys that are bought and sold, that are imported from other countries. And unfortunately, we do not have a law that prohibits import of these animals. What that means is that whenever we get animals from other countries, there's nobody checking if these animals are clean, if they have viruses, if they don't have viruses. There is no protocols for these. So what you can do is to not be a part of this. Do not purchase this exotic wildlife. Encourage people you know to not purchase these animals as well and keep them as pets, because these animals belong in the countries that they come from. They do not belong here. Also, if you are in a place where you know that live animal markets take place, and I'm not talking about cattle fairs, I'm talking about animal markets where everything from a dog to snakes and monkeys are sold, with turtles and everything live. These live animal markets happen in multiple places across the country. I know Rajasthan has some of these, Gujarat has some of these. Make sure you're working with your local administration to not issue permission for these live animal markets to be conducted in the interest of public health and safety. Now that this pandemic has occurred, everyone is more alert. So we need to leverage that to make sure we don't create another one. The other thing that we need to do, which is critical at this point of time as well, is to ensure that all pet shops, you'll see pet shops in your area, which could be aquariums, it could be stores that are selling parrots, parakeet, lovebirds, as they're popularly called, sun connoisseurs, a lot of these species. All these pet shops need to be registered with the municipality under the pet shop rules, which are a part of the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. The minute they are registered and licensed under this act, they can be regulated and monitored by the administration. Right now, almost no pet shops are registered, which means they can get away with just about anything that they do without anybody questioning them. The other thing that I would urge you to do is to only buy meat for consumption of those species that are prescribed by Food Safety and Standards Authority of India for consumption, which are mainly your chicken, goat, all of these species, and not to buy any wild animal meat. Also, when you're buying the meat that is prescribed by FSSAI, to only buy them from outlets which are authorized by FSSAI. There are a lot of illegal meat shops and markets where you see live animals and animals being slaughtered for consumption then and there. Those have the highest chance of being a breeding ground for pathogens. So do not buy from there at all. What can you do in the current scenario? Again, Hansen has covered a lot of this, so I'm not going to repeat it. The animals that are at risk are companion animals. By this, I mean the animals that are in our house as pets, your dogs, your cats. Community animals, which are animals out on the street. Again, mostly dogs. India is home to a little over 30 million dogs on the street, and thousands of cats and cows and everything else. And animals in pet stores. That's a very, very important part of it as well. What can you do for companion animals? So the minute this lockdown was announced on the 24th of March, HSI started working with the Ministry of Home Affairs immediately to bring out a circular to say that veterinary services are deemed essential service by the central government. We also helped the central government put out another circular to say that all the stores related to having pets, like your pet food, cat litter, all of the stores that sell these items are also deemed essential, which means that as per government order, all your veterinary clinics, veterinary hospitals, and pet food stores and pet supply stores can remain open. In a lot of places, they are not open. That is where you will have to call your district administration, your DC's office, or your animal husbandry office to make sure that these clinics and supply stores are functioning as per government orders. And these orders are, of course, valid across the country. They're not specific to any one state or district. We have called several district administration offices from the end of March to now to make sure that they are open. What we are also going to do is very soon put out a list of clinics and stores on our website of different cities where these clinics and stores are open. So you can also refer to that, but call your animal husbandry department or your district administration to make sure that these supplies, that these clinics are open. One of the reasons for abandoning animals, like Hansen said, is that people believe that cats and dogs can transmit COVID-19 to humans, which is baseless and false. Another reason is that people are saying there are no veterinary clinics that are open. I cannot take care of my dog or cat. I cannot buy any pet food, and hence I need to abandon the animal. not having access to supplies or not having access to veterinary care cannot be a reason to abandon animals. So abandoning pets, if I go and tie my dog somewhere outside on the street, or if I don't go and dump my cat somewhere, it is illegal under the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, and it is punishable by law. If you see anybody abandoning an animal, you obviously don't want to risk your own self by going and trying to stop them, because you don't know them. What you need to do is immediately inform the local police and record any information that will help find the owners. Recently in Madurai, there was a case where two people in a scooty abandoned a dog and went away. Fortunately, somebody took a video of it and they sent it to us. We were able to file a complaint against those people, and the police are now on the lookout for them. So not only will you inform the police, you can also call the local animal welfare organization to help take care of the dog, to figure out what can be done with the dog. And like Hansen said, identify alternate caregivers for your companion animal in case you fall sick. This is good in any scenario, not just the current one, but just any scenario. Again, in any scenario, keep all your vaccines up to date of the animal and a minimum stock of any medicine or food that might be required. The supply chains for most of dog and cat food are good across the country. We haven't had many instances. There have been some cities, but not many, where there's been a shortage of food. Most cities have them. And considering that after the 20th, after today, supply chains are going to get a little bit easier, you should not have access to, you should not have problem accessing food. But do not hoard all the feed that you can. Just because you're getting access to it, do not hoard a lot of food. Keep in mind that others need them as well. So buy very, very responsibly. For community animals, the truth is a lot of these animals, they've been on the street all their life. They will get by fine. There are some places where these animals are dependent on humans for food, like markets, for example, where there are no homes, there's no commercial activity. That's where they need support the most. So again, the minute the lockdown was announced, HSI India worked with the central government, the Ministry of Home Affairs, and the Animal Welfare Board of India to make sure that there's a legal provision for those who want to feed animals in the form of a feeder pass. So you can go to your district administration. Again, this could be the DC's office, or this could be the animal husbandry department. You can go and you can procure a feeder pass that will allow you to go out at a particular time and feed animals. You have to ensure, of course, your own safety and care when you're doing this. The best way to do it is to deposit a bunch of food in a place. You don't have to hand feed these animals. Like Hansen said, you don't have to play with them. You don't have to cuddle with them. You don't have to kiss them or hug them. You can just leave food for them, and that is good enough. That's absolutely good enough. And the good thing is that in most states like Kerala, for example, Calcutta, and quite a few Orissa, the government agencies have taken on feeding of these animals, which is very, very heartening. So if the government agency in your city is already doing feeding, the best thing that you can do is to identify areas where their efforts need to be redirected. If there are certain areas that they don't know of that you know, please redirect them to these areas. Any such locations, inform the department about it, so the feed can also be distributed there. What you can do is, until the government mechanism kicks in for these community animals, you can go about feeding these animals like Hansen described, with minimal interaction with the dog at all. So this is a really important one for us, because the minute the lockdown happened, we saw that there were a lot of pet stores with animals inside that were just closed overnight. So what this led us to do is that we again worked with the Animal Welfare Board of India to issue a circular to say that all the district commissioner's office will have the power to open such stores, break open if the owners are not to be found, and rescue the animals and care for them. We've done this in many instances. This is just one of them.
So
in this pet store, you'll see a dog. There are many dogs, birds, many animals locked inside, and the owner was not to be seen for many, many days. We then worked with the DC's office in this area to have these animals rescued and fed. What we've also done is this circular from Animal Welfare Board of India. We have circulated this to all DCs across the country. But you need to ensure that if you see a pet store in your area, listen if you hear sounds of animals from inside. If you hear sounds of animals, contact your DC's office or your nearest animal welfare organization immediately and ensure these animals are rescued. We've already seen several pet stores where animals have actually just starved and died inside. So ensure that doesn't happen. The last one is, of course, working animals. Now, these are animals, the reason I call them working animals is these are animals that are used in the entertainment industry. In weddings, for example, these horses are used. The New Indian Express put out this picture a few days ago from Hyderabad, where these horses have just been tied and left. And the owners of these horses were asking NGOs to support and rescue these animals. Now, these are horses that are owned by somebody, and somebody is making money from using these horses in weddings and things like that. It should be the onus of the owner of these animals to care for these horses. It cannot be the NGOs doing it. They can be assisted by the Animal Husbandry Department of a state in terms of subsidy for fodder, but it cannot be anybody else feeding them. The owners have to take responsibility. And if the owners can't take responsibility, these animals need to be taken away from them by the police or the Animal Husbandry Department. A few additional measures that you can take. So HSI India has prepared an FAQ of frequently asked questions on COVID-19 and animals. These are available in 10 regional languages in India, aside from English. We would strongly advise you to, we can send them to you. You can distribute them to as many people as possible. These are very, very, very informative. Tomorrow we'll be putting out a small video that will also send out the right message and more messaging on why you should not abandon your companion animal. Again, this is without any dialogues in them, so it's language neutral. You can again take this, send this to a lot of people to spread awareness from them as well. We have seen that regional media and even national media takes a lot of new findings, new research that's coming out, and often make them sensational news item. Like a few days back, there was a study that came out from a university in Canada, which was severely flawed study that suggested that dogs could be one of the intermediary species. Now, we put out a white paper saying why this paper is not true, but there were several local media channels that picked up on it and started spreading panic. The minute you see anything like this, you should absolutely use the power of social media or even just telephone to call them and say that the World Organization for Animal Health or the World Health Organization has said that animals, these companion animals, do not transmit COVID-19. And hence, ask them to stop spreading false information, which also under the National Disaster Management Authorities Act are illegal to spread and spread false information and create rumors. So we've also sent notices to a lot of the media channels. And fortunately, they've responded and taken this content down now, all except for one channel. The other thing that you can do in the long run is to ensure that the animals in your community, such as stray dogs, are vaccinated regularly, and there is animal birth control happening, so the numbers, the population is regulated overall. This is a picture of our FAQ, and that's my email ID below. You can email me and ask for the FAQ in any language. We can send you the English. We have them in Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, Punjabi, Assamese, Odia, in many, many languages. You can ask for it. We'll be putting out more and more content on our social media pages. And all the content we put out will be in 10 or 11 regional languages, including Urdu. So you can ask us for this information. We'd be very, very happy to share this with you. And like Hansen said, always keep checking the website of the World Organization for Animal Health, because they have the most updated information on this. That's about the time I had. I'm sorry, I had to rush through it a little bit, but we do have another 10 minutes for questions, I think. Praveen, over to you.
Thank you.
Praveen, you're not audible.
Praveen, we are unable to hear you.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry. So now we can go through the chat box as well as some participants, directly with the participants as well. So let me start with the participants. Is that fine?
Yep, sounds good.
Yeah, sure. So let's start with Manoja. Manoja, I'm going to unmute now. You can speak.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
आवाज आ रही है क्या?
हाँ जी, आपकी आवाज आ रही है, please go ahead.
हाँ, सभी को नमस्कार. मैं ये पूछना चाह रहा था, जो कुछ जगहों पे जैसे declared है, जो ये गली, ये मोहल्ला जो है, तो कोरोना वायरस मोहल्ला हो चुका है, लगभग लोगों को वहाँ है संक्रमित और जांच चल रही है, तो उस जगह पर हम जानवरों को कैसे रोकेंगे जाने, जो रोड स्ट्रीट डॉग हैं या जो गाय वगैरह जो चलते हैं उनको कैसे रोक सकते हैं वहां जाने से? दूसरा एक है जो ये है तो इतना व्यवस्था, लेकिन ऑलरेडी बहुत सारे हम लोग चूंकि 27 तारीख से काम कर रहे हैं, इसके पीछे राहत कार्य में कर रहे हैं, ठीक है, तो क्या इसका कोई गवर्नमेंट सपोर्ट या कोई ऑर्गेनाइजेशन सपोर्ट करेगा इस सब चीजों को, उनको कुछ जानवरों को जो खाना खिलाने के लिए या उनको कुछ पीने के लिए देने के लिए, इस सब टाइप का कुछ?
Right. I can answer Mr. Manoj's second question. I'm sorry, my Hindi is not very good. So if somebody can help translate, that would be great. I can answer your second question about anybody supporting animal feeding. So technically, this is supposed to be done by the government, by the Animal Husbandry Department. In a lot of states like Orissa, the government has set aside a sum of money to only feed animals. Unfortunately, this is not something that they give out as grant to any other organization. But certainly, there are many, many individuals who are now coming out to support people who are helping animals. The simplest way to do, if you don't have an organization of your own, is to join hands with another organization that is registered and already doing this work. So you can actually get some portion of their resources that they have. That's the best way to go about it.
सर, हम बेसिकली बिहार के लिए पूछ रहे हैं आपसे. बिहार में जो स्थिति है, मधुबनी डिस्ट्रिक्ट में हम काम कर रहे हैं, ठीक है, और मधुबनी डिस्ट्रिक्ट में जो लोग हैं उनके लिए तो प्रॉपर व्यवस्था हो नहीं पा रहा है, ठीक है. हम लोगों ने कई ऑर्गेनाइजेशन को भी लिखा, मैंने यूनिसेफ के एक दो साथी को भी मैंने ये चीज कहा है, ठीक है, लेकिन अभी तक कोई उसका व्यवस्था हो नहीं रहा है जो हम लोगों को सहायता कम से कम पहुंचा सके. सरकार कोई व्यवस्था नहीं कर रही है, ठीक है, उस स्थिति में जो है हम लोग कैसे सरवाइव करेंगे, क्योंकि संस्था की भी एक लिमिट है, हमारी भी कैपेसिटी लिमिट है.
तो अभी हम बिहार
में हम लोग क्या कर सकते हैं,
बिहार के सरकार से हम बात कर रहे हैं अभी इसी के बारे में. बिहार के जो प्रिंसिपल सेक्रेटरी है उनसे बात चल रही है हमारी. एक या दो दिन में शायद ये भी सॉल्व हो जाएगा आपका
प्रॉब्लम, क्योंकि नीति आयोग बार बार चिट्ठी लिख रही है, मैंने उसके लिए मेल भी किया, सब कुछ किया है, लेकिन अभी तक कुछ हुआ नहीं है, ठीक है, तो ये समस्या है हमारे साथ.
थैंक यू, हम आपको अपडेटेड रखेंगे, हम बात कर रहे हैं बिहार के सरकार से.
थैंक यू,
ठीक है थैंक यू सर.
लेट्स टेक फ्रॉम डॉक्टर रजनी श्रीवास्तवा. रजनी श्रीवास्तवा, आई एम गोइंग टू अनम्यूट नाउ.
आई एम फ्रॉम प्रयागराज. हेलो,
यू आर ऑडिबल, प्लीज गो ऑन.
या, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर रजनी श्रीवास्तव फ्रॉम प्रयागराज यूपी. My remark is that not a question, because of lockdown, so many birds, so many animals, they all are fleeing very natural surroundings, and the burning issue is, since 1/3 lockdown is over, so how it can be sustained in coming days, in coming time? So it's a big challenge for all of us. Can you throw some light on it, on this burning issue? Because lockdown is not available every time. Hello.
Hello, Dr. Rajni.
Dr. Rajni, I'm not entirely certain I understood, but I think what you're saying is that with summer setting in and more of the lockdown to go, animals will feel the heat for sure.
Yeah.
I think the simplest thing that we can do, even if you're not able to feed animals, the simplest thing. Yeah, the simplest thing we can do is to place a bowl of water outside our communities, outside.
Yes, we used to do it. We are doing all this at our level best.
Correct. So I think that's the most that we can do. I think the government mechanism, the government response is also slowly coming into play. Governments in many states are being very, very proactive. Kerala, for example, the police are going out and feeding dogs. They're very proactive in that sense. A lot of the governments are doing this. The Rajasthan government is giving subsidy to all the animals that are owned in Amer Fort as well. So they are doing it. But I think from our end, the simplest thing we can do is to work with, say, petrol bunks or shops to keep bowls of water and food out for animals. That has been very successful so far.
Thank you. We have an interesting question from the chat box as well. One of it is, what are the chances of spread of COVID from human to animals? What are the preventive measures to protect animals from being affected by COVID? And also, what precautions should we take in case of bird pets?
I think what I do want to clarify is that viruses like the SARS-CoV-2 can jump species barrier. It can jump from humans to animals as well. But from what we know, animals don't get affected by this virus. Even in the two cases that Hansen mentioned, the two dogs which were tested positive, a week positive, one of them later tested negative, which basically means that if I have the virus, for example, if I go near an animal, the virus might jump from me to the animal and the animal will test positive, but the animal will show no sign of sickness. It will not show any sign of being affected the way humans get affected. That's what it means, which means that it's not a danger to these animals. And all I'm saying, all we're trying to say is that this is still an evolving subject. There have been two or three cases. There was the case of the tiger in Bronx Zoo as well. The tiger is doing well now. The tiger is getting better. There's also the good information is that the tiger has not passed it on to any of the other animals. To explain in a very, very simplistic manner, there are about 19 amino acids that this virus binds with in humans. And some of the animals like cats share about 16 of these same 19 amino acids. So some of these animals they can get the virus from us, but they cannot get affected the way humans can. That's the bottom line. So it's perfectly safe to be around them. You don't need to protect, you don't need to do anything extra to protect your animals from this virus. Anytime you take them out for walks, you bring them back in, make sure you wipe their paws with a wet cloth or with a sanitized cloth, wipe their fur just once if you can. Aside from that, you don't have to panic. Pets are absolutely safe in this regard.
Thank you, Sumanth. And we have another question asking, what can pastoral communities do whose migratory nomadism are deterred amidst this lockdown? Pastoral communities.
Is Hansen going to take that?
I can take that.
And Hansen, yes. The second part of that question is also that, are there any specific government guidelines or policies for supporting such particular pastoral communities? So if there is anything, you can maybe highlight that as well. Thank you.
Oh, right. Yeah, I missed that. Thank you.
Right. Actually, yes, regarding this, specifically for pastoral communities as such in this situation, the thing is like, because the world everywhere, we are paying, the governments and countries are asking that we restrict our movement and maintain the social distancing norm. I think it is important that we need to see how we abide by all the government rules and that are being put by the governments, respective governments at this particular time, which is very crucial. So please kindly abide by these rules. I know it's not easy, it's very difficult, especially for communities who are rearing animals in the pastures. They need to move, they need to feed their animals, understand, but wherever possible, whatever is possible, please kindly try to follow and that restricted movement at this time. Second aspect of guidelines. For guidelines specific to this biological disasters, NDMA has a guideline called Management of Biological Disasters that was released in 2008. And this is talks about all biological disasters in general. And there is one particular specific chapter on livestock disaster management, which they have highlighted a lot of gaps that needs to be addressed. And I feel it is a perfect time for us to see how we can address, because there are a lot of challenges and gaps, as I shared in my presentation, that we need to work on. But as someone is asking for a guideline, there is a guideline, but now we need to see how we can take measures and implement and make it operational in coordination with all the stakeholders, with the government, with the local organizations, with the community. All we need to take active measures in our whatever we can do in our respective areas. So that is, but you can go through the guidelines. It's on the website of NDMA. Like you can, if you just put management of biological disasters, you can get that. And it is a good reference to see how we can manage all biological disasters.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doc. Thank you. And can we take one or two, a couple of more questions from the participants?
Yes, please.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. So let's go with start from Anjana Ganguly. Anjana, I'm going to unmute you. You can speak now.
Hello, sir.
Yes, we can hear you. Please go on.
Please.
I'm Anjana from World Vision India. I just wanted to know, are animals responsible for COVID-19 in people?
Thank you, Anjana, for your question. Actually, yes, there are a lot of rumors and fake news that have been circling, getting circulated around. So as again, I would like to repeat and highlight the fact that animals don't transmit, don't get infected or get transmit this infection to people. So we need not worry about it. But again, I would like to reinforce the point that this is an emerging situation. As of now, whatever information we have is they don't transmit and they don't get infected. But please keep looking out for information from reliable sources like World Health Organization, Organization for the Animal Health, that is OIE, and Center for Disease Control and Prevention, like sources which are really reliable. Because even for the case of people, the situation is evolving every day. We are studying and we need a lot to, there is a lot that we need to study about this virus. But as of now, you need not worry, there are no such issues and they don't transmit or get infected by this virus, madam.
Thank you. Now, shall we take our last question right now? And one, we have DK. DK, I'm going to unmute you. You may speak now. Thank you.
Hello.
We can hear you, please. Go on.
Yeah, sir, I'm from Manipur, and the question which I want to ask has already been answered. But the one thing, I'm a human rights activist. So, but now this session has, given me a new insight and a new conviction that I should also work for animals' rights. So, you have also mentioned about the course which has been provided by your organization, so and I'm interested to do that, and then what else I can do, to get more knowledge about the animals' rights and how I can advocate for the animals' rights.
Right, thank you so much, Mr. Deepen, for your questions. In fact, it's really very encouraging to know that you have developed the interest and the passion for protecting animals in such situation and emergency situations. Coming to your point on the course, World Animal Protection has developed a course called PrepVet, which is otherwise called as Veterinary Preparation. Okay. So this course is acknowledged by the United Nations. It is being developed in three languages, English, Spanish, and Portuguese. For English, this has 11 particular modules. It is a self-paced course. When I say self-paced, anyone can log into this course, register, and start this course. And you can get an online certificate as well from this course. And this will help you to learn about the different aspects of dealing, managing animals in disaster situations. Likewise, there are many other courses as well, if you're interested, and trainings offered by different organizations. And this subject actually is slowly emerging. In India, we are also having a program called Veterinary Emergency Response Unit. We have established 6 such regional veterinary emergency response units in the country, in the veterinary universities. Since you're in the Northeast, we have it in the Assam Veterinary College. So we have dedicated course for veterinarians, government officials, for a national disaster response force, the rescue personnels, and so on. So there are a lot of things. If you're interested, you can learn, you can write to us as well. So then we can see how we can encourage you or provide the necessary resources for you to learn on this subject.
Yes, thanks, sir. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, dear speakers. And thank you for the wonderful session. And thank you, participants, for your patience and attending the session. And we right now announce our next session, which is on child protection needs and psychosocial support to children. And which will be from 4 to 5:30 p.m. tomorrow. And as you know, it will also be streamed live on YouTube as well. So you can click the Zoom link for the registration, and you'll get a mail notification. And you can join the platform 15 to 20 minutes prior to the time. And also, if there is any trouble logging in or registering, you can always reach us on the contact which will be shared with you. And we have been receiving many comments and suggestions on the certificate issue, which is one thing we would like to clarify, that in the registration portal of the COVID-19 Academy, there is a quiz which will be activated after 24 hours of the completion of a session. You can go to the website, you can click on the quiz, you can attend the quiz. You can provide the email ID, the same email ID used for the registration, and then you can provide your name and you can download your certificate from there. So, and you can always write to us if there is any problem at covid19academy@sphereindia.org.in. Thank you again for your support. Thank you to your speakers. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Praveen. Thanks.